this morning. We're going to continue with our series, Are You Ready for the Return of Christ? It's remarkable what's happening out there in the news. And I was ready a couple weeks ago when I preached about the day of the Lord. I'm really more ready now today. Boy, we need Jesus, and the world needs Jesus. Amen, church? Amen. So, we've been reading a variety of passages from the books of 1 Thessalonians, and now we're entering into 2 Thessalonians. And the Thessalonian church, Thessalonica was the town. These were places that Paul went and shared the gospel, and people received Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. And so they were very excited to hear about, well, what does it mean to be a follower of Jesus? And as they learned more about Jesus, you know, a natural question for them would be, is he coming back? And Paul said, of course he's coming back. And there's going to be these events that are going to happen that are going to accompany his coming back. Now, why do they want Jesus to come back? Well, Jesus is the hope of the world. And they, at that time, were going through an unbelievable amount of unrest. Unrest for themselves, because there was a great deal of persecution for anybody who followed Jesus as their Lord and Savior. But there was a tremendous amount of unrest in the world. There was this dominion of the Romans, and there was always talk of, well, who's going to be next? What great empire is going to come up next? It just wasn't good. So they wanted Jesus to come back. Matter of fact, they wanted Jesus to come back so much, one of the things that Paul had to bring them comfort in is, you haven't missed it. They wondered if they had missed that Jesus had already come back, and we're left here in this thing called the tribulation. Paul said, no, he hasn't come back yet. But he keeps explaining it through these two letters. He sent one letter, 1 Thessalonians. A few months later, he sent another letter, 2 Thessalonians, and he keeps reiterating this. And I think, folks, this is a pattern that needs to happen to us. Talking about the second coming of Christ. We need that. We need that for our own comfort. Is the world crazy now? I mean, we've seen statues coming down, and I wondered this as I saw the statues coming down, when the first person would be to say, images of Jesus need to be gotten rid of. And already that's happened, right? This is a peculiar world. There's much unrest. This is a context that is similar, not the same, as that in the Thessalonians. They want Jesus to come back, and I hope you do too. I hope that you long for the coming of Jesus. And so we're going to read today, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 3 to 10. I invite you once again to stand for the reading of God's Word. We hold God's Word in high regard, and thus we stand when we read this. Picture this in your mind. Paul's writing a letter. We ought to thank God always for you, brothers and sisters. And rightly so, since your faith is flourishing and the love each one of you has for one another is increasing. Therefore, we ourselves boast about you among God's churches, about your perseverance and faith in all the persecution and afflictions that you are enduring. It is clear evidence of God's righteous judgment that you will be counted worthy of God's kingdom for which you are also suffering, since it is just for God to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to give relief to you who are afflicted along with us. This will take place at the revelation of the Lord Jesus from heaven with his powerful angels, when he takes vengeance with flaming fire on those who don't know God, and on those who don't obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will pay the penalty of eternal destruction from the Lord's presence and from his glorious strength on that day when he comes to be glorified by his saints and to be marveled at by all those who have believed, because our testimony among you was believed. People of God, this is the word of God. You may be seated. So, you know, I thought, man, I'm coming back from vacation. I feel refreshed. And the first sermon I have to preach is on judgment. That sounds like a sermon to give before you go on vacation and then get out of town. I have to say, as a pastor, it's not the most attractive subject to welcome you back with, and the many people who are watching. But it's absolutely a topic that we have to talk about. Why? Because it's true. So I don't preach this sermon here this morning out of this passage of Scripture to somehow scare you into the kingdom of God. Not at all. A matter of fact, I think that this passage of Scripture, like the entire Bible, are messages of love to us from the Lord, grace stacked upon grace, to remind us, folks, we need to be ready. We still have time to be ready. So one of the things we planned on our vacation, and I have no idea how providential it would be even for this message this morning, was that we wanted to see the Creation Museum and the Ark. Some of you have gone to that in Kentucky in the last couple years since it opened. So when you get to the Ark, we thought we might see it from the road. You don't see it from the road. Actually, you pull into the exhibit, you park your car, and you take a little bus in, and then suddenly you get a picture of this Ark. Now, on the one hand, it's not completely surprising as to what it looks like, but on the other hand, it is big. Now, all the details that they could follow from the Scriptures, they did in terms of the dimensions. And one could go up to that Ark walking with somebody, and they could marvel at, wow, is that ever big? They could walk into it, and they could see all that wood on it. As a matter of fact, a Christian might be walking in there with a non-Christian, and one could say, oh, well, that was all, first of all, made of gopher wood, because the Bible says it was made out of gopher wood. Okay, wow. Look at those long boards. And when you walk in, there's three levels. Why are there three levels? Because the Bible says that there's three levels. And you can walk in and you can marvel at all the potential places for animals. You can marvel at all the potential places for water storage, all the potential places for the feed for the animals during this long journey in this ark. There's so many things to marvel at and go, ooh and ah. But what was it used? The ark was used to save people from judgment. A matter of fact, they even have a display in the ark, of which I never really thought of it this way, but I totally agree with this. They had a little display in there of a bunch of children's books that they have actually gathered together that made the ark sound like a fun thing. Matter of fact, I remember a song we used to sing in junior high, Arky Arky. Some of you remember that? It sounded fun. After all, we bring all the stuffed animals in, two by two, right? They've all got big smiles on their faces. And Noah and his family are there. And we've made it to be almost like a fairy tale. Well, folks, this is not a fairy tale. The ark was used to deliver from the judgment of God, eight people and two animals of every kind. And everybody and everything that wasn't in the ark perished. It perished. That's the message. So beyond all the awesomeness of this big thing, behemoth thing that you can see in a field in Kentucky, this was deliverance. This was grace that God showed to these eight people, and the story goes on today. If the ark isn't a big enough reminder of us of what happened then, here we have the church. The church. Who is Christ coming back for? Christ is coming back for the church. It's not a matter of being a member of a church, per se. It's a matter of having your lives committed to Jesus Christ and being a joyful follower of Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus is coming back. That's the church. The visible church, like what we see right here, that invisible church that has gone throughout the generations. God will deliver his people from the judgment that's coming. And so Paul is going to talk very clearly about this, because the second coming of Christ will be the climax of history. It is going to happen. so this morning, I'm just going to ask a variety of questions. Questions that, if you already have all the answers to, great. This will be hopefully an affirmation. If you have these questions and they haven't been answered, hopefully they'll get answered. But why is Christ going to return in the first place? Why is he coming back? Well, as I just said, the Bible makes it clear that Christ is the groom and the church is the bride. This institution called marriage that was instituted way back at the beginning of Genesis, this theme carries forth all throughout Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, where the church is called the bride, and the bride is making herself ready. And just like in those Galilean weddings, of which this would have been the pattern that Jesus would have even been thinking of, that bride was taken out, raptured away from her home to go to be with the groom at that wedding. She didn't know the date or the time, not like today where we're planning a wedding for sometimes 2 years and know the exact day and the caterer and all that. No, it was a surprise because the groom came like that thief in the night and brought her away. This is the climax of history. What does the bride do until her groom comes? The bride adorns herself. I know, men, this is sometimes hard for you to hear as men, but we are part of the church. We are to adorn ourselves. We are to read the Bible. We are to practice holy habits. We are to be ready for the coming of the groom to take us to that great wedding feast in heaven. That's one of the reasons Christ is coming back. And he is coming back to reclaim that which is his. I mean, when you go back to the book of Genesis, and you look at Adam and Eve, but Adam in particular, that first Adam, and he relinquished that which had been given to him. God said, it's yours. Claim it. Claim it. Have dominion over it. So they had everything, and what did they do? Because of sin and their desire to have something that God said you can't have. They relinquished it, and so the devil moved in. And the devil started claiming all of this stuff for his kingdom. And so we as Christians, one of our mandates to do in our lives is to continue to claim back things for Christ. Because the devil is a thief. And the devil keeps stealing the things that God has here, gifts for us. And so ultimately when Christ comes back, Christ is going to come back with this, it's over, devil. I'm getting it all back now. You're done. And that's going to be the climax of history. And another reason Christ is coming back is, remember this, just before he left the first time, there was the humiliation of the crucifixion. And Christ became all of that on the cross so that we can have life, that our sins would be paid for. Of course, he came out of the tomb. He was resurrected so that we could have eternal life. But make no mistake, when Christ comes back this second time, it will be in complete glory. It will be in such a way that every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. That is the Lord. For those people who believe that there are other lords, other gods, Muhammad, Buddha, whoever, on that day, make no mistake, everybody who is alive is going to bow down. That is the Lord. Jesus will come back in complete glory. And then what this passage in Thessalonians says to us very clearly, he will come back in the fire of judgment. Fire of judgment. We don't typically run towards fire. We run away from fire. But he's going to come back and he's going to judge because he is perfectly holy. And those who are in Christ will have been made perfectly holy because of what he has done in saving the Christ follower. So he's telling this to the Thessalonian church, and he's telling them this to bring them comfort. And they're hearing this and they're going, yes, that's so good what Christ is going to do. And Paul's words to them is, stand firm in that. Now that was 2,000 years ago. We don't know. Christ can come back tonight. The Thessalonians knew that. We know that. And it may be in 2,000 more years. But dear people, whatever you see on the news, whatever you see happening, whatever you see on unraveling of the world, stand firm because Christ is coming back. The question, what will Christ's return look like to the believer and the unbeliever? Well, according to this passage, for the believer, there'll be relief. There'll be rest. There'll be refreshment. There'll be peace. And what will there be for the unbeliever? Vengeance. Punishment. Retribution. Which side of that do you want to be on? And so the next question would be natural. What does vengeance look like for the unbeliever? Vengeance. Well, vengeance, oftentimes, when we think about it in human terms, we think about revenge. You did something bad to me. I did something bad to you. So that's revenge. That's not God. Okay? God isn't, you know, mad up there in heaven now. And, oh, I'm going to get even with these sinful people. That's not God. As a matter of fact, the scripture is very clear on that. God would have that all people would be saved. That all people would be saved. That would be his desire. But that's not going to take place. People are rebellious. People are saying no. People are putting their fists out at God and saying no, no, no. But he will come back in vengeance. Vengeance, in one way to describe it in this context, would be it's perfect justice. Those people who are outside of the Lord's family will receive their due justice. You know, I think of a story that I read this week, a story about somebody going into the doctor, and the doctor says, you have cancer. And the doctor says, man, I love you. I'm just so concerned about you, but you have cancer. And to the person who hears these terrible words, you know, they come to him and say, well, what can be done? Well, we can, there is a surgery that can be done, and it would require cutting you open and taking out this tumor and the cancer around it. But I love you so much, and I think so much of you. I don't want you to go through this discomfort. The discomfort of the surgery. I'm so sorry you have cancer. Well, can you imagine a doctor like that? No, of course, what you want to do is you want to submit yourself to the surgery because he said if you cut into me, that you can actually get it out and eradicate this terrible disease for me. Yeah, but I'm all about love. See, folks, this is what people do with God. They say, God is wrong. God is not going to do anything like this. It's even in vain in the church. God isn't going to do this. Yes, he is. How do I know that? The scripture says that. Well, how do I avoid this judgment that's coming, this vengeance that's coming? You're going to have your hearts cut. You're going to have to surrender your hearts to Jesus. Is that a bad thing? No, that's a good thing. He takes out this cancer called sin. He makes you a new creation. You trade your selfish will in for his generous will. Your life is turned upside down. But we can't stand in our own sinful muck and say, God is love. He'll just take me as I am. Because the scripture doesn't say that. God provides the surgery that we need to give us life to the full right now. And life, of course, eternally within heaven. So who will these unbelievers be that this passage is talking about this morning? Well, Paul refers to some. He talks about those who afflict. See, the Thessalonians were being afflicted by mean people, by people who persecuted them, by people who ridiculed them. And, of course, the Romans, who were so much specialists of death, they did terrible, heinous things to Christians during this era, to persecute, to kill them. Terrible, terrible things. Paul says, those who afflict, the Lord's going to come back and bring his vengeance because they hurt each other. They do terrible things to other people. And we can certainly think of those people throughout history. I mean, big names of people who have just hurt other people on large scales. And there's also people, perhaps even in this room, who have hurt people and afflicted people. There's salvation available. But people who hurt people are all out there. They're out there. What other groups of people? Well, those who don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They never made a commitment to follow Jesus. they kind of played around with Jesus. As a matter of fact, they even said silly things like, we're priesters, we go on Christmas and Easter. Yeah, we only take Jesus in a couple times a year, kind of at our pace. You know, it's kind of nice. You know, it's nice to have the kids grow up and go to those little Christmas programs. That's special. And we walk in a little Noah's Ark stuffed animal set and things like that. And we put a plaque that we got from the, you know, the little craft store. That's Jesus for us. They were people who maybe sat in church for decades with no personal relationship with Jesus at all. The Lord's vengeance is going to pour out on them. Going to church for these people was like going to the barber or the beauty shop. I'll do it regularly, but there's no real personal relationship. Kind of like with my barber. I mean, it's not much. This isn't judgment coming to folks. And then there are those who don't obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those who have no interest in obeying the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those who don't even want to look to find out what the gospel of Jesus Christ is. See, when you don't have a personal relationship with Christ, why on earth would you desire to do what this says? Are you really? I'm not judged. I'm never going to be a judge. I'm never going to audition for God Jr. because that role isn't open. But when somebody tells me they don't read their Bible, it's hard for me to believe that they have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. When somebody never practices the habits of what a Christian should be, just the basic habits, the holy habits, it's hard to believe that they have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And so when people don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, why would they care what the Bible says about this issue or that issue or this issue? You know, there's a whole lot of issues that are going on out there. The most recent one that we see out there is this great racial divide that's out there. And it's still in existence. It's horrific. Does the Bible address it? Yes. We treat all people, with love, dignity, and respect. But in fact, one of the things that the Ark brings up very clearly, and I wish we could all embrace this, when we look back in history, we're all sons and daughters of Noah, right? That's one race in my book. And that's what we need to follow. But why would we even be interested in that if we don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Why would we be interested in preserving life if we don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? Why would we be interested in what the Bible really says about forgiveness and living in a Christian community if we don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? The fact is, you wouldn't. You see, if I didn't have a personal relationship with my wife, I probably wouldn't go home every night. Why should I? I wouldn't really care what made her happy or sad or angry if I didn't have a personal relationship with her. I may expect some things from her, but because of a lack of a relationship, I'm not going to go out of my way for her. But of course, I do have a personal relationship with my wife. You all say, duh, of course you do. And because of that, that dictates behaviors on my part. That's what relationships are about. So the question is, do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Do you want to do what He wants you to do? Do you want to learn more? Do you really care what this says? I mean, really, what this says? Another question that comes up is this: how will this look like for the unbeliever? Well, this is a tough thing to talk about, folks. I can only talk about bad news because I hope by the end of this message I'll have more good news than I'll have bad news. But when we talk about this, we have to talk, what does it look like for the unbeliever when Jesus comes in judgment? Well, we've got to talk about what hell's going to look like. Now, just like the Bible gives us clues about what heaven is going to look like, the Bible also gives us clues as to what hell is going to be like. And I would say one of the greatest words that could describe hell is this: ruination. Ruination. Everything that makes existence worthwhile is gone. Do you hear that? everything that makes existence worthwhile is gone. Some people might say, coming out of bed, you mean there'll be no ice cream? You mean there'll be no, you fill in the blank. Everything that makes existence worthwhile is gone. People who go to hell won't cease to exist. And see, that's a popular myth that's out there. People believe that when I die, they put my body into the ground and it's over, finished. So I'm going to live however I want to live because when this heart stops beating, everything else does, it's all over. People who go to hell will not cease to exist, but they will experience this uselessness, hopelessness, emptiness, meaninglessness, no value, no worth, no accomplishment, no goals, no hope. Some people like to just have these images that, you know, that's this fiery place, and they've made it almost to be into some sort of a kind of a horrifying cartoon, of which they get to the point where, well, that can't be true. That can't be true. This is true. Hell is going to be a place where there's no hope. None whatsoever. It's a dark place. Paul uses the words, it's going to be away from the presence of the Lord. Well, interesting, when we delve into that theologically a little bit, it gets a little bit weird because, of course, if it was completely outside of the presence of the Lord, that would mean that God is sovereign. Exactly where God is sovereign, God is everywhere. But what Paul means here, away from the presence of the Lord, is simply this. It's away from any display of God's splendor or majesty. Any display of his splendor and majesty, because this is God's judgment. You know, we live in a sinful world right now. It's a sinful world. But you know, when you look out there, you know, we look in Iowa, we see these rolling places with corn growing and soybeans. It's beautiful. We just got back from a trip and we saw the great smoke. It's beautiful. We've been to places like Yosemite and California. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. This is all in a sin-tainted world, a sin-smeared world. For the Christian, one day we're going to see the new heaven and the new earth without any of the smear of sin. Well, believe me, hell has the smear of sin all over it. It's going to be ugly. Jesus said that it was going to be a place of darkness. There is no good in hell. There will be no relief in hell. There will be no shred of beauty or pleasure or joy or peace. So when songwriters write silly, stupid stuff like, I'd rather dance with the sinners than cry with the saints, because that's their view of heaven and hell. Oh, how they are mistaken. The lost will share hell with the devil and his angels because that's where they're going to be cast. The devil is not going to be ruling hell. The devil will be done. The devil will be a co-tenant with all of his angels in hell with the others. There will be frustration, weeping, gnashing of teeth. There will be no rest, day or night. There are no real words to really express this reality. But let's move to relief. What does relief look like for the believer? When we think of relief, we think of relaxation. Heaven is a place of relaxation. A place where you don't have to look over your shoulder anymore. You don't have to wonder what bad thing can happen next. There's relaxation. There's a sense of easing. You know, so many of us carry burdens, and if you could just imagine carrying a real heavy box up a flight of stairs, and somebody's at the top of the stairs, and they say, "Let me take that from you." That's what heaven's going to be. There's not going to be any more burdens. We're not going to be hunched over with anything. That will all be lifted from us. And what else will we have there? There'll be freedom. Freedom. Complete freedom with no sin at all in us. To enjoy. To take in all that has been prepared for us. And there'll be rest and refreshment. That's what's there for the believer. Another question. So are you saying a loving God will judge? Love John 3:16 and 17. I love it too. Believe me, for God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. Only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is the message of salvation in a nutshell. And then it goes on to say, for Christ did not come into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. That's absolutely true. And Christ has come into the world. And the message has been left. He brought the message. He's given it to us to share that message. Go and be my witnesses. That's what we do. But He also said, folks, there's going to come a time where this is all going to come to an end. Keep sending the message. That's why the church has sent the message out since Christ has sent it into heaven. Because there is going to come a time where Christ will come back again in judgment, and those who aren't in Christ will be condemned. It's right here. So we have things that both are happening. Christ did not come into the world initially to condemn the world, but to save the world. And that's what we're part of, extending that grace to others. In the book of Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 to 15, which I'm not going to read to you at this time, you can read it on your own, but I think it's one of the most sobering passages of Scripture. It's described as the great white throne judgment. And why is it so sobering? Because it tells of the final judgment of the inhabitants of planet Earth. The last sentence of this passage is chilling. What does it say? It says this: anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's what happens to those who aren't in Christ. They're cast into the lake of fire. But make it plain, what is going to happen to people when they die? As I preached a few weeks ago, I said, you know, when we die, if we happen to die today and we're in Christ, what we do is we go to heaven. It's not the final place, but it's the place that we would go to today. The final place is the new heaven and the new earth when the world comes to an end. And when you die and you're not in Christ, you go to hell. Of which also isn't the final hell, because there will be that lake of fire in the final place. There will essentially be two judgments. We'll call the first one the first court. It's for the Christian. This is the judgment seat of Christ. This is what happens to Christians when they meet Christ in the air. 2 Corinthians 5:10 says this: for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may be repaid for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. So this is the judgment seat of Christ that Christians go before. Now we're going before Christ, not waiting to find out whether we go to heaven or hell. No, we're going to heaven. This is all about the things that we have now done. So we're in. So when we die, what happens is this sin is all off of us now. So we're going to stand there before the Lord confident. We're going to stand there confident. And see, what Paul also says in 1 Corinthians 1:8, he says, he who plants and he who waters are one, but each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. So this is where rewards came in. I preached about this a couple weeks ago, and some people said, that's in the scripture. Well, here it is, 1 Corinthians 1:8. And also 2 Corinthians 5:10. Let me give you another one.
Paul also says in Ephesians 6:8, whatever good thing each one does, this he will receive back from the Lord. So there's this talk of rewards that we get as Christians in Scripture. How about the parable of the talents? One given five, one given three, and one given one. And remember that one reproduces to ten, and great is the reward. One has three and goes to six. Great is the reward of the one who buried it. Away from me, you're not getting me. So there are these rewards that are there. And then John Piper, he's a pastor that I really love to read. I found this little reading. He says things so well, so I'm just going to read it to you. But you know, he says, you know, 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So those of us who are in Christ and who have prayed that and said, Lord, cleanse me from my unrighteousness. I want to be your follower. I want to be your child. Of course, he says, yes, I do forgive you. Yes, you're in the family. I adopt you in. And so when we die, what's going to happen is the blood that has covered us over all of our sin, we're going to go there guilt-free and shame-free to that judgment. But he says, there is going to be something that happens. And he says this, it will make a difference in this way, the fact that we've been redeemed. Here's this picture. He says, I'll picture the deeds of my life, the good deeds of my life, the Holy Spirit fruits of my life as being filed away by God in a filing cabinet under the heading Evidences of Grace. So imagine that for a minute. Every one of you, there's a file cabinet with your name on it, for those of you who are in Christ, okay? It has your name on it, and that file cabinet is going to be opened on that day of judgment. Evidences of grace, evidences of new birth, evidences of faith, those are necessary. Otherwise, when the courtroom is held at the end, and the judge says, what evidence do we have here that the person by faith is united to Christ? Who is his perfection? My ground of acceptance is totally Christ, not the filing cabinet. That filing cabinet is fruit of faith in perfection, and that perfection is the ground of my acceptance. So his blood covers all my sin. His perfection comes for my perfection, and the judge is smiling upon me in Christ, and I know that I will make it because of Christ alone. We sung that song. The filing cabinet is taken out, and it has these two functions. Number one, evidence that I was born again, that you've been born again. And it may not be a big file. In fact, there are a lot of bad grades in there, and they'll all be thrown away. And the B minuses and the B pluses will be taken out, and they'll say, well, that's what's needed in order to show that he was born again. These things would not have happened otherwise unless he was born again. Therefore, his is in Christ. Therefore, he's totally acceptable. And the other function is that I think there will be varying rewards on the basis of that measure of fruit. So that one will get five cities, and one will get 10 cities to rule over. And this is John Piper talking, and I'll get a little Georgia village. So that's the way I think it works. It's a beautiful picture. I hope you've grasped hold of that. See, the fact of the matter is, folks, when we belong to Jesus and we're born again, it's not that everything we do is big, grandiose, Billy Graham-like. No. Matter of fact, so many of the things I do, it's not always A work. It might be B plus, B minus, even C work. But the fact is, working for the cause of Christ. It doesn't matter what the grades are. What matters is, are we doing what we have been gifted to do for the cause of Christ? Is there any evidence that I'm a Christian? And then these rewards will be handed out. And like he said, some will get 10 cities, some will get 6 cities to rule over. I just want a little, maybe a little village in Georgia. That's his story. That all happens, folks, in the first court. The second court. The first court is reserved for the believer. The second court is the great white throne judgment. This is for the unbeliever. There will be all sorts of people there. That's what Revelation says. Those who appear very evil, people that you might sit here today and think, well, they're going to go. terrible people in history, those people are going to be there. But folks, there's going to be pretend Christians that are there too.
Jesus made that clear, didn't he? He said there will be people who said, Lord, we cast out demons in your name, we did this, we did that, and they will be there as well.
These are people who pushed Jesus away because they only wanted a little Jesus. They wanted Jesus on their terms. They wanted Jesus but didn't have to follow this. There's no grading on the curve here. People love to grade on the curve. I'm better than most, but I'm certainly not as bad as those people. There will be a judge, but there will be no jury. There will be a prosecution, but there will be no defense. There will be a sentence, but there will be no appeal. There will be no yes buts that we can say. Because there will not be an ability to defend yourself or to accuse God of unrighteousness or of saying, that's not fair. It will be final. Your name is either in or not in. And so for the passage that we have closed, this is what's very clear from this passage. Jesus will be revealed. It says that verse 7. Jesus will descend, it says that in verse 10. Jesus' throne will move from heaven to earth because he is ruling right now, we say in the Apostles' Creed, at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Well, when he descends, that throne will come down here, and there are things that are going to take place now down here. Jesus will return with his mighty angels, it says that in verse 7. Jesus will come in flaming fire. It says that in verse 8, flaming fire of judgment and purity. Jesus will enact judgment, justice. That says that in verse 8. He will inflict vengeance. Jesus will judge those who do not know him. Verse 8. Jesus will banish those who have rejected him. Verse 9. And then it says this, folks. The saints, those who are in Christ, they will marvel at him. That's what the Bible says. They will marvel at him. You know, we know right now from the book of Revelation that there are saints, martyrs gathered in heaven, and they're saying, when, O Lord, are you going to avenge for our blood? And there will come that time, and then the saints will all be witnessing what will be happening there, and we won't have the attitude of, good, they're getting better. No, I don't believe that's going to happen at all. What I do believe is the Lord is back. The Lord is back. And just like what he said on the cross, when he said, it is finished. Your sins have been paid for. So he's going to come and he's going to finish this all up. And sin will be banished from this world and we'll be ready then to enjoy the new heavens and the new earth for all eternity. That's something to look forward to. So folks, there's bad news that we've talked about today. It's really bad news. But the good news far outweighs the bad. And we have the message. I'm sure there are those people that walked around to know and said, what are you doing? I'm sure there are people that said he was nuts and probably called him a bunch of other names. I'm sure there were people that even got around and wanted to sabotage him or do whatever. But this ark was going forward. Because the Lord had ordained the ark to go forward. And I'm sure Noah said, God says the world's going to be destroyed because of all the sinfulness that was in this world. And people said, eight people got saved. The rest of humanity was banished. So where are you at with Jesus Christ? And who in your family, who in your sphere of influence needs Jesus? This is what it's all about. This is the gospel that we proclaim. This is why we do this thing called church. This is why we gather. This is why we pray and hold things on Wednesday night. This is why we're not going to shut down. We're going to continue to declare the words of Jesus. Because, folks, talk about judgment. It's uncomfortable. It sounds painful. It sounds ugly. Because it is. But we look forward to the one day when there is no cancer, and there is no strife, and there is no riots, and there are no protests, and there are no racial discriminations going on in the world. There's no COVID-19. There's nothing. This is all gone away. And this is the time when we all get to heaven, and we sing and we rejoice in what a glorious day that will be. But until then, Lord, we have to give this message. So, Lord, for each one of us today, there may be people in this room that they're not taking Jesus seriously. This is like going to the beauty shop or the barber. I'll come occasionally. Lord, I pray that those people would move, that there'd be a step that they would take into taking their relationship with Christ seriously. This is not something that we want to take chances on. Lord, I pray that each one of us would fall deeply in love with Jesus, and if we don't know Jesus for the first time, that this would be the day that we say yes to your invitation. Lord, I know you died on the cross for me, my name, and I receive all that you have for me. I want to live my life for you in everything I do, and I want to go closer and deeper every day in my relationship with you. Lord, I pray that there would be people that would pray that prayer today, and then take that prayer to others. We love you so much that we just thank you that in the midst of strife, in the midst of judgment that's coming, that